and FAA green on our project. The motion on the floor is just talking about community to vote to reduce police presence in their neighborhood. Without any further ado, I would like to call the first Republican speaker to open the meeting.
Yeah, yeah, boy, that's ya.
In his response to this discrimination. These people are harassed, they are stopped in prison for no reason and for no with no adequate cause, right? And that's the point at which they have to live in fear. They are more in danger from the police. These people, we think, are the best decision makers because they are the ones who are affected by the crimes that happen in these communities, and they are the ones who can make the decision about whether or not they need these police officers there to protect them, right? Because if they think they need them to protect them, they will vote for them to protect them. This is the point at which opposition can't come out and say that people will vote down police numbers so crimes can go unpunished. The idea that communities sit together in dark rooms and plot together to commit crimes is absolutely absurd. We think that's ridiculous, right? So how does this help? When you have fewer police officers, you can't indulge in discriminatory practices like randomly stopping an immigrant person and frisking them, right? Because you have to have these police officers directed to the crimes that need to be solved, right? Because the actual crimes that need attention now get attention because they're exactly the right number of police officers in that community. People feel safer on the street. You don't have the numbers to randomly stop Muslim men and shoot them when they refuse to put their hands up. We think that is an inherent benefit on our side. It prevents a culture of fear, which is bad enough, right? And we think this fear leads to less reporting, less trust, violence towards the police, and all those are outcomes we prevent on our side. We don't think another benefit that occurs on our side is that police personnel can't be lobbied into these poorer communities by richer communities, right? Often, different classes of people within a city see a certain community as a problem. Richer white majorities lobby for more police personnel going into black areas like Harlem. They think that these people are the root cause of all the crimes that they suffer from, and they do not understand the amount of discrimination and repression these people face from the police force, and they can no longer do this using the money and power that they have at will, right? We think this prevents unnecessary violence, unnecessary discrimination. Another thing that happens on our side, moving on to my third argument, about how this increases cooperation with the police. The people literally choose how many police personnel they deal with in daily life. They made the choice to have them there. In their mind, it legitimizes their presence. They increase trust levels because you have a choice, and the police force as a whole becomes accountable to you as a community. They only stay as long as you want them to and as long as they are of help to you. You stop telling your child to walk the other way when they see a police car. That's the point at which you stop fearing silence, even though you've done nothing wrong, because you made the choice to have those police personnel there. You make the decision to report a theft you otherwise wouldn't have reported because you were afraid some blame would have been pushed on you, right? You cooperate more willingly and you help them look for evidence. Why is this useful? We think that in the status quo, people don't report, right? They don't go to the police even when they've been affected by a crime. They don't help them by helping them find evidence, right? And we think that this is why the justice system becomes more effective on our side. We think that's an inherent benefit. That's why opposition can't come out and say crimes go unpunished, because in an area where there is no trust, there's less cooperation. Criminal cases take longer, and there's no reporting. You can't solve an unreported crime. And the police force as a whole has less of an effect when they're focused on discriminatory practices. We think for all of those reasons, we stand to win this debate. We are very, very proud.
Is really, really concerned about individuals not being able to trust the police in today's case. They need that just by you choosing the number of people that exist within that kind of community, you automatically have more trust in these things that exist there. You automatically have people being less scared or less intimidated just because they are the richest number. They also say in their speech quite explicitly that these people basically just don't trust the police. They feel that they've done more harm than good. Then reducing this number, how do we then correlate that kind of relationship that they all exist today? Two things are visible in my battle. This point about how we just need to be giving these people the freedom to choose whatever it is that they want within their society. But then secondly, how we then shift the kind of stigma that exists within these communities where richer communities see them as the problem, right? But before I even get into my rebuttal, here's what we're going to prove to you as side opposition. We're going to prove to you that this is not the right solution to the right problem. How do we do this? I firstly tell you about what the real problem is and what is the best solution. I secondly even tell you why voting isn't necessarily something of value in today's debate. Thirdly, then I tell you that why is it that I could give government this kind of choice to enact, to be enacted by the government. But then lastly, we give you the concrete terms of their policy and show you how we can make it all work within today's debate. Our second speaker then speaks about how we live like our Western kind of societies that we live with as he furthers our case, right? So two points of rebuttal. Firstly, choice. Firstly, just don't think that choice is something that is inherently like non-restrictive, right? We just don't give people the freedom to choose anything that it is that they want because they are allowed to choose. We don't just say, hey John, you can choose to kill anybody because hey, that's your choice. We evaluate the kind of choice that you're able to make in that kind of position and whether or not it is in fact valuable to that kind of society, right? I further tell you this in my math, right? But here we're telling you that when that kind of choice is able to put more other people at a disadvantage and not just you, we just can't be in that position where we say it's a modernized thing to do, therefore we do it. No, right? Then we also get this idea and the choice that, hey, people have actually also get this idea that police have done more good, more than good. These people are therefore eligible to then choose because they know about the struggles that they face on a day-to-day basis. But then we tell you that there is an inherent reason why we had so many police in that kind of community, right? For these reasons is why we had them there. If these reasons then happen to decrease or they happen not to exist anymore, we tell you that there is an organic reduction that also happens within the status quo. Why is that therefore not relevant inside proposition? We need to argue to that, right? But then they also then tell us about these intervals and like how do they choose that, hey, we only want to see police at this time. We tell you that they worsen crime then in these instances. Because I know that, hey, that policeman will only pass at 2. I better commit this crime at 1 o'clock. By the time it passes by, I'm not actually going to be caught. Tell you that they worsen the societies in which they live in. It just even therefore want this to therefore exist. Because we are aware that crime is something that is constant that happens at different times. We cannot be put in position, people like under the pressure of deciding when this actually happens, right? Second point here, they tell us about the stigma that we actually don't like. We concede. We don't want rich communities to be viewing poorer communities to be the problem, stigmatizing, right? But then how do we therefore better the kind of stigmatization? We tell you firstly that they worsen it under their side when they have like a reduced number of police and there's more crime in these poorer communities. So they have like the ability to then run rampant on crime and actually they invade these communities per se. They actually are like heighten the perception that these people therefore have, right? But then secondly, here we tell you that under our case, we then are there to like show you now better how we therefore like better this in its entirety, right? So firstly, what is the real problem in today's debate and what is the best solution? The real problem, like I say, is within the justice system itself. When we have hints of racism within the justice system and the people who are trusted to administer this justice, right? We tell you that you have people who, police in particular, who are unable to properly deal with criminal situations. Here's what we tell you is the alternative, as opposed to just voting for the reduction and rather than the reduction doesn't work, right? We tell you that the alternative here is to have things such as sensitivity training that are administered to these police, where we have things like de-escalation training, where they're taught how to calm down the situation, not aggravating and being aggressive and use things such as weapons, right? We tell you that And thirdly, we have like body cameras that are even instituted in San Francisco as we speak, right? Where we have the sensitivity training, all these mechanisms that implemented. Police brutality decreased by 93%. These have been proven to work. They need to tell us why these alternatives they will not go to exist, especially when we want to address the very same problem they have, which is police brutality, right? So now why don't we therefore like this idea of voting? Tell you that people have been like introduced to an idea that is very exaggerated by the media, where you have police brutality being aimed almost all of the time. This means that it fiddles with the capacity that the individual has to make a rational and well-thought-out decision, because everything has been hyperbolic, and they are forced to consume the fear that is being broadcast and mold. They are forced to consume the kind of things that the media wants them to consume, retiring businesses. They are therefore not very rational in that instance to therefore act. Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, at the point at which these minorities live in the constant fear of being cracked down by police, why don't you think it's their choice to...
Nicely onto my second point, onto my third point about why we feel the government is best capable to make this decision and not the people, right? First thing to tell you that the government is better able to evaluate the spectrum at which this crime actually exists and allocate people, because they have more information, they're able to gather more information as opposed to individuals themselves. But then secondly, we tell that it's because we have personalized definitions of crime which don't necessarily apply or are like aligned with the laws that country, right? We tell you when we have a society that is patriarchal, when we have a society that is very homophobic, they wouldn't necessarily think that corrective rape is a crime in that instance. We have to make people like realize that we have a standardized way in which we evaluate crime. We therefore can't necessarily have people who are just going to vote for something just because it happens in that kind of context, right? But then thirdly, yeah, we tell you that security is something that is overlapping and the government is better able to evaluate this. Why? Because they realize, ladies and gentlemen, that especially when people have different stories and people live different lives, like what you may think, what is very unjustified is having a majority rule over what you think is criminal. Like, if you are an American black woman, you are less likely to be worried about being shot by actually being raped within that kind of society. When your majority think otherwise and they vote for a reduction, that simply puts you at a disadvantage. You feel that you're not only endangering yourself, but you're endangering the vast majority that is staying, especially minorities that they're trying to then protect. Right? So the concrete harms of their policy is firstly that you heighten crime at its base. But then secondly, especially in these kind of neighborhoods that may exist that are largely like really poor or very violent in their nature, you feel that this is more likely to happen. But secondly, and most importantly, that you decrease the kind of conversation that we want to have. We don't want people to just finalize things upon votes, because that's what votes do. We want people to be able to conversate about things that police are doing to them and what they think is justified to happen in the kind of society and the kind of justice they deserve, and not just think that a reduction will solve all their problems.
The speaker spoke for 8 minutes and 20 seconds. I think the first one to the speaker, and I would like to invite the second one. Came out and said that people know when the police are around and will commit crimes at other times. Apparently at 1 o'clock there's a police and at 2 o'clock there's no police, so at 2 o'clock you can commit a crime. We don't understand what they do on their side to ensure that there is constant policing at every single point. So they seem to propose that they have infinite police who can be posted outside every house at every minute of the day. We don't think that's possible. They need to tell us how crime rates reduce. have not been able to answer any of these questions, we are winning this debate already. So what will I be doing in my speech today? I will be giving you some rebuttals to the alternatives that they proposed to reducing police brutality, and I will then go on to rebutting the responses they gave us to the PM speech. Next, I'll be telling you exactly why those responses didn't really make sense, and all the material from PM is still standing. And finally, I will move on to my constructive on how it increases the accountability of the police to the people. Now, coming to my rebuttals. Firstly, they told you that freedom of choice isn't given to everything. And they gave you an example of, hey John, you can just go kill someone by giving you the choice to do that. No, we are not giving you the choice to commit a crime. Instead, we are giving you the choice to report a crime. That choice is taken away on side opposition, and it is something that only we do. Next on this idea of how, next on their alternatives that they propose. They told you that the police will be changed to in these matters of de-escalation and how they will be asked not to get out armed that easily. We tell you that this is not the police brutality that they do is not something that they do out of chaining. They are not chained to do this. This is something that they do because they have this stereotype that all those who belong to the minority are more likely to commit crimes, and therefore they just believe that these people are people who can be harassed, people who can just be assumed to be committing crimes irrespective of what they're doing. We don't think this is something that is taught to them in chaining. It is something that they have learned in that they have learned through the way they see society as. It's a stereotype that exists. We don't think they change that. De-escalation doesn't work. Next on the idea of why you can't have body cameras. Firstly, who actually monitors these body cameras? The ones monitoring these body cameras are the superiors who are more white policemen. These white policemen also believe that police brutality is the right thing to be doing. There's no real way a body camera can be enforced either. Therefore, all the alternatives they produce to reduce police brutality just do not stand. Our way is the only way to be doing this. And finally, what they told you is that it decreases the conversation between people within communities. They did not explain this at all. In fact, what we think is that it only increases the conversation in communities. We need an answer to that from side of opposition. So what is it from the PM speech that still remains standing? We gave you the principle. We told you that this choice is not an arbitrary choice. It's a choice to deal with people who give up. It's a choice where you are able to deal with people who can shoot you at their will. They literally said society as a whole decide to reduce police officers so that individuals can commit crimes. We don't see how this makes any sense. We think they need to answer this as well. Also, the next thing that we told you was that this decreases police brutality. Once again, this remains standing. We've told you why none of the alternatives stand. The only way to reduce police brutality is on our side. And this is extremely important because this is the only way that minorities will finally start to report crimes. Minorities will not be afraid to walk out of their house, to go to the grocery store, to buy milk, because right now, in their minds, the opinion they have of the police is that the police can take them to the police station at their will. The police can take them to the police station and conduct inquiries on some apparent criminal charge which they can apparently justify, but really they cannot. It's just white people being mean to all of these minorities. Once again, police brutality only decreases on our side. And finally, we told you how it increases cooperation between the police and the people of these communities. We received absolutely no response, and this is important because these people now believe that they are safe in these societies, that they can move out of their houses without being afraid that a policeman can shoot them out because they are pulling pills out of their pocket to take some medicine. We think that because the laws in countries like the US allow this to happen, we think that it's required for this, for there to be an increased cooperation between the police and the communities. We think on all three of these, we are still winning. At this point, I'll leave.
So, ma'am, what we think is, why in that situation where you think that race is the inherent issue within how police operate, why would you not just create a vote to have more representative police within your community as opposed to removing the police presence from your community?
Okay, so when you say more representation of your own community in the police, we think that what ends up happening is that you believe that the person of your brotherhood has actually gone over to the other side and the person has betrayed you to go to the police. We don't think that, we think that the police is regarded as someone whom they hate irrespective of the color of the police who is committing this brutality against them. Now finally, to my constructive on why this increases the accountability of the police to the people. We think that this decreases the incentive for police to crack down heavier on communities, and why is this? We feel that what happens when there is a system of voting? The police feel afraid for their job. They realize that if they continue to be brutal towards minorities and discriminate against them, then they won't be voted in to continue for the next term. The community, if they're still being oppressed against it, they're still being harassed, the community will vote for the number of police for them to reduce. What happens then? The police are afraid that they will have to, that they will lose their jobs, or that they will be transferred out of their, out of where they stay. They will be transferred to another police station. They will lose their support structures. The police themselves are scared for their jobs. And we think that this is how this system brings about accountability, because they realize that the police can only do what they are supposed to do, that is to keep crime rates down, to ensure that there is no criminal activity going on. We think that it is only when the police do this, that this policy is implemented, that the police face this accountability, because right now they are only accountable to their superiors, who, as we told you, are just more white men who don't care what these policemen do. We think when you have these policemen accountable to the people are going to ensure that the only thing that happens is crime rates reduce and the police brutality reduces. We think that for all of these reasons, we have been able to conclusively prove to you that in areas where crime rates are high, we reduce the crime rates. In areas where police brutality is high, we reduce police brutality. We think minorities are better protected on our side. Until they tell you any reasons why all of what we've told you does not stand, we are very proud to prove.
So the reason I can stand up there and tell you why all of what they said doesn't stand is because side proposition has fundamentally misunderstood why brutality actually happens with the police force, right? They've already conceded that it isn't because police aren't trained that way. They've told us that it's because something between the police and the people themselves. So what we think then is that the reason this sort of brutality happens is fundamentally because of a disconnect between the police and minorities and the people who get oppressed. We think fundamentally you only worsen that disconnect when you tell people to send the police out of their communities or give them the power to do so. We think what you really need is reconciliation between the two parties, right? So, onto my rebuttal. Here I will tell you that there are a few issues with their policy primarily. One, we think these issues fundamentally come from the idea that their policy is percentage-based, right? So the first reason that this is a problem is that they give actual criminals power, right? We think when we tell you that certain individuals in society would vote in a certain manner so that they could commit certain crimes, we're not saying that communities want to commit crimes and they all huddle together and want to, like, plot to commit crimes. What we're telling you is that because your vote is percentage-based, you give every individual in that society a part of influence in the vote. So criminals have a vote where they can decrease the number of police. When you have organized crime, like gangs and the mafia, those people can vote and have a large majority of the vote to decrease the police presence in those cities. That's fundamentally harmful. You increase the possibility of crime. Secondly, we tell you that that percentage-based model simply reaches a position of compromise if you have a situation where you have, for example, men who seem to appear more thuggish, so they vote for less police because they feel more in danger, versus women who would potentially vote for more police because they want to feel more protected. In that situation, you have a system which is not as good for neither group, and you don't really enshrine either of their right to choice in that situation. And furthermore, we would like to just like, end this point on policy by asking proposition if they would ever allow a situation in which there was completely no police within a society. Okay, now we need to move on to the second issue, which is how we help minorities. This is what they asked us to do, I'm going to do it for you, right? So it's like proposition told us four things. One, that crime is unreported because of a lack of trust with the police. Here we would tell you that the reason crime is not unreported is, yes, because of that lack of trust, right? But the problem is that side proposition doesn't give you that trust. They just remove the number of police. It doesn't mean that I trust individual police officers anymore simply because there's fewer police officers. I'm still as scared to go to the police station where the few police officers that are in my crime-ridden community are actually sitting and asking those police to help me because I still don't trust those police. For all the reasons I proposition told you, we don't trust police. We don't trust people based on that, the number of people they are. We trust them based on their integrity, right? That's why our model works better. That's why we tell you when you need integrity, you need better sensitivity training. And we tell you they can't just say sensitivity training and body cameras don't work. We told you in San Francisco there was a 93% decrease in systems of police brutality. We told you, I tell you now that in New York a similar system happened where there was a 73% decrease in crime. In the UK, the police are so good that they actively disarm situations without the use of force whatsoever. The same happens in Canada and Sweden. Police have the potential to be very good from good training, and that's what we support on outside the house. Furthermore, we tell you that body cameras inherently work if you can trust them to a judge and show that the dude killed someone without any good reason. We would then further tell you that the reduction of the police does not make people safer, right? Reduction of the police simply means that you are less likely to have a policeman who may be a bad policeman who commits acts of brutality. What you do, though, is that you increase the potential for crime in that community. More on this in my speech. So here I've fundamentally told you how we help minorities. We do it by not making them more, putting them in a situation of more danger like doctors. Okay. Secondly, is how we make society in general safer. Proposition told us in this idea that we brought up about not having infinite police, right? Because when we use the idea of the 2 o'clock versus 1 o'clock example, what we principally meant was that when you have more police, there is more chance that police will be there to observe a crime or respond to a crime. So our proposition needs to engage in that manner. Okay, so now onto my substantive matter. I think I've successfully dealt with their first and second speaker's case, because they were basically copy-pasting from each other. Now, firstly, I'm going to talk to you about how we increase the harm of police brutality within society. So let's look at this in a system where we're going to look at A, the police, and B, neighborhoods. Okay, we're going to specifically look at what happens when we implement cross motion, right? So when we look at the police, we think what we see is that primarily there are fewer police in the neighborhoods, as proposition would tell you. That's fundamentally what they're proposing. So what we think then is that the police who are in those neighborhoods are stretched thin. And two, that the police in those neighborhoods do not readily have as much backup, right? What this means for those police is that they are less able to make rational decisions because they have divided attentions because they're stretched thin. And secondly, they feel more unsafe because they are less able to call for good backup. We tell you when people are less able to make rational decisions, that's when they have bad decisions being made, that's if you have more brutality occur. We also tell you that in these situations, more police get killed. In high visibility police boxes in London, a policewoman was killed like 3 weeks ago because she was a police officer, right? She was just stabbed in the neck, okay? We think even when you have a high police presence, you still get crimes sometimes being committed against those police officers. When you lower police presence, you fundamentally increase the dangers on the police officers who are there, which means that the police officers who are there have more reason to be harsh and swift in what they act on, and two, have more fear driving their emotions and their thoughts. So then, that effectively characterizes the police in their situation up here. Secondly, we need to look at the neighborhoods, right? And I'm having to take a PRI now if you want to do more. Yeah? Yes.
Since you seem to agree that minorities should trust the police, why do minorities trust the police more if there are more of them?
Okay, we don't have to prove to you that minorities trust the police more if they're more of them. What we're proving to you is that taking away more police doesn't make them trust the police anymore. Like, you can't tell us when your model is to decrease or change the number of police that we have to prove that numbers matter, right? You need to prove that they will trust more if there are fewer police. You can't prove that, and I've told you how you can't prove that. Furthermore, we would tell you that the way you get them to trust police is to make the police good at their jobs and actually, like, they have this sort of sensitive training and they have nothing else to it. Okay, so now onto neighborhoods, right? We think in neighborhoods, one, fundamentally, you get a situation where you probably have an increasing crime. This means that one, the situation is more dangerous for anyone in that neighborhood. Two, you have a higher probability to encounter a criminal. And three, there are potentially more people calling the police to report crimes. Which is interesting, because in the majority of cases of police brutality, at least in the West, it was police responding to a police call, right? Mike Brown, for example, Sandra Bland, Tamir Rice. Literally a guy diving away from a party when the police were called was shot in the back of the head. We think if Proposition fundamentally wants to decrease the number of police brutality occurrences, having people more, like, turning more police into, like, volatile situations is not the way to go about it. We don't think that they should put any sort of situation where you can get an increasing crime. Secondly, we would tell you that you create neighborhoods where criminals have more ability to avoid the police. Because gangs have the vote, like I told you earlier. You literally give the mafia the vote to lessen the police presence, right? What this means is that you potentially create hubs of crime, right? And this negatively affects not only your own neighborhood, but other neighborhoods. Because when gangs have a base of operation, they can affect more people on a wider range. This deepens the distrust between the police and the people because of the fundamental nature of the fact that the police may be more likely to encounter a criminal. We think, furthermore, that vigilantism becomes a thing when people have the ability to enact justice as they want to, right? When they aren't police, when they don't have police presence, they can vote the police out and they can do what sort of justice they want to. We think people can then deal with crime in the manner which they feel is more justified instead of via a standardized system. We think specifically then, if you look at the interaction between the change in the police and the neighborhood, what you see is that there's fundamentally more chance for both police brutality and apartheid because the few police who are there are the ones who potentially are bad. We don't think brutality occurs because there's lots of police, right? Because not all policemen commit brutal acts. It's the bad policemen that commit brutal acts. They haven't told us how they remove bad policemen from the system at all. They've just told us that there's less chance of having a bad policeman in your community, guys. Okay? We think fundamentally you create more bad policemen on the side where police are less able to act rationally. If you really support helping people, you have to side with opposition.
Minorities on whether they want to engage with the police, right? We told you border reciprocity. At a point at which state has so much coercive machinery in order to take away your rights, restrict your freedom of movement, restrict or put you in jail, incriminate you, lock you up, and ask questions to you, is at the point at which you should also give a reciprocal right to the communities to actually hold these police officers accountable, to actually put a check on this imbalance in power, right? But which they told you that this choice is non-restrictive. And they gave an example about how like this somehow is equivalent to the choice that we supposedly provide of murder, right? We believe that it's not true because of the principle of moral reciprocity, right? Because you can't randomly kill another person. That is immoral and that cannot be principally justified. We believe that there is a reason for us giving this choice, and at the point at which they cannot deny that fundamental basis on which this is based on, they don't win the principle. And by virtue of us winning the principle, we win this debate on that alone, right? But then let's assume that it didn't happen, which you shouldn't, but let's do it, right? Let's look at a utilitarian perspective. Firstly, on which side reduces police brutality? We told you that at a point at which these minorities are so afraid of the police, right? At a point at which the police discriminately and disproportionately crack down on minorities. At a point at which, when a black woman reports a case of rape against her, police say we're overburdened with cases and just refuse to report, actually probe into these cases. But at the point at which they're free to stop and frisk cars, random cars with black men on the road just because they have a broken headlight, is a point at which it is not a problem of numbers, right? It's a problem of allocation and it is a problem of perception. At the point at which they characterize these minorities as criminals, and at the point at which they do not treat them as equivalent to the majority, is the point at which police brutality is a problem, and which is what we reduce. At the point at which policemen can be transferred, at the point at which policemen can be laid off because of police brutality, is the point at which we can put this on check, right? These communities are actively incentivized to hold these police officers down, and at that point, we believe that it is obvious that police brutality will decrease, something our deputy told you, but they haven't really adequately responded, right?
Okay. Okay, so what proposition just told you is that the fundamental problem is within the police force themselves and how they interact and treat minorities. They don't actively fix that, they just make less police, right? They must fix the actual problem.
Thank you, sir. But let's look at how this works, right? People are not going to randomly lay off police officers from police stations, right? At the point at which there's a reduction in the number of police in a particular area, the senior police inspectors are probably going to lay off those police officers who are particularly charged with these police brutality cases, right? They are going to effectively crack down on these bad policemen, some issue that they brew right out of proportion in the ALO, which is why we believe there is accountability for our side, right? Moving on as to which side has more cooperation, right? We told you at a point at which they have control and they have a sense of control over the policemen, right? They have a sense that at the point at which they don't really respond to their needs, and at a point at which their interests are not aligned with their these minorities, they get to reduce them in number, right? That very feeling in itself will create more trust between the minorities and the police. At the point at which they can slash 20% of policemen in a minority community, and the police officers are cracking their heads as to which policemen to lay off, which are often people who are discriminating against these people, there's the point at which they believe that the police officers who are in these police stations are good people. There are people who can, they can trust and they can approach, right? And if they don't find that the case, they can just vote their numbers down in the next election, to the point at which the good police officers are concentrated in their community, and this is the only way in which they can achieve that outcome, right? And we believe that this is where trust builds. At the point at which you can openly go to the police station without fearing that you'll be stopped, without fearing that you'll be asked questions as to why you have come here and what are you doing, is the point at which these people start building trust and start reporting more crimes, start cooperating in the case of as being witnesses and actually cleaning up the CJS process and court cases, all of that is infinitely benefited on our side. Thirdly, on the situation of reduction of crimes, right? This is very important for them to win. They can't really say we reduce crimes because of less policemen, because it's solely based on the assumption that these minorities are filled with criminals. That is not the case. We have clarified this right from the beginning. Often, the victims of these crimes are the people in that very community. They care for both the police and the criminals in this area, and the only opt-out mechanism they have out of this is probably the choice being given, because now they can get out of the deadlock by having more trusted police officers, by actually being able to approach these officers, and at the point at which that happens, we believe that crime actively reduces, and thus we are the side that protects these minorities. I am very proud of you.
We hope Team India are not also in frequent, because that means their brutal strategic mistake is going to cost them a break. Importantly here, we need to understand that when they don't engage with what our policy is, but more about recharacterization of what the actual problem in society is, their policy and their attempt to try and fix it is going to be entirely ineffective. We gave you from 01 a substantially different approach to what the problem with police brutality is. We tell you it's not individual police officers or the number of them, but rather the system in which they exist. We tell you it's because they're told to prosecute crimes which black people are disproportionately more likely to be part of. We talk about minority sentencing when it comes to possession of marijuana. We talk about a justice system, moreover, which is less likely to hold these people accountable. We talk about various mechanisms which they literally say are way too good to be true. How is that possible that policy could be that effective? Like, when that is exactly how real life works. We tell you that those are the ways in which we get police officers who commit brutality to be prosecuted, and moreover, actually introduce some sort of consequences for that police brutality. Under their side, they do nothing. Importantly, though, we give you analysis how, regardless of what police brutality exists in the moment or how you change it, this isn't going to be the way in which this isn't a beneficial policy for the way the society works. Let's talk about two clashes. Hopefully, you don't think that six of it, then two. Let's talk about the substance of these arguments as opposed to the content, the number of them. Okay, initially, here, let's talk about how police should be allocated, and I'll be talking about how society reacts. They tell us about how there is an important principle of how people should decide how much police and where the police are in a society. They tell us about the coercive nature of police and the amount of violence that they can enact on you. There's a fundamental problem with this analysis because people are conflicted. They simultaneously want to be as safe as possible, but they also want no consequences for their life at all. What that means is the state needs to step in to manage the balance and trade-off between those rights. That's incredibly important when you're conflicting interests. Here we have a good example of corrective rape, where the majority of that society are not going to be victims of that thing. Like, if you're not a gay woman in that society, you're going to be fine. In that situation, the majority don't feel the effects of that crime, but the majority might think it's perfectly fine that the police don't need to be prosecuting them. They don't want to be prosecuting themselves. In that situation, we tell you that there is a democratic way in which the majority is going to win when that's not necessarily the best outcome. The state is valuable in stepping in to make sure that security exists for the people who are most affected. We don't think individuals well, and the majority are in the best case to decide that analysis has been existed. Secondly, let's talk about what, like, they tell us that people should also be able to decide because currently they feel under threat. Let's talk about the way that people make decisions, the rationality argument, which has been typically engaged with. Here we tell you that one of the threats of police brutality is far, like, it's very serious, sure, but it's far exaggerated by the media, where I think the statistic is like more than one black person is killed a day by the police. But we're literally talking about thousands of gun violence crimes, which aren't given the same significance. That people often disproportionately underweight gun violence because it's seen as less comical, less sensationalist, less likely to see a protest against it because that's the police's job. Importantly, there, what that means is that people greatly exaggerate the risk of police brutality in their neighborhoods and are much more likely to go against the police than against crime. Secondly, what we told you is that you cannot see what criminality looks like until you actually exist in that situation. We often think that people exist in a situation of relative security because the police are doing their job, and imagine what that's like because they experience it through the news. We say that unsafety and the feeling of not being able to exist in a society ravaged by crime is one in which you cannot ever imagine in a rational way. When you're making a vote on a piece of paper, you do not imagine what your life would be like, you simply imagine the headlines. That's specifically problematic and sensationalist, but more what we need to understand, the majority of them does not necessarily care about the most important issues, and the more we will not make the best decisions for the best number of people. You say, Connie gave you an analysis about how a compromise between women wanting to feel safe from rape and men wanting to not be seen as thugs is going to lead to a middle ground in which neither is accommodated for by the police station. Importantly, there we give you an analysis about how the government should decide, about how we're talking about a high crime area in which the government says that there needs to be a lot of police here. Here, we're talking about people who have crime stats, who have information, and who can be engaged in a rational manner, allocating the best police to the best situation to best keep society safe. Importantly, it's the conclusion of the principal argument. At best, what they do is they mitigate people's fears around policing as opposed to their tangible safety in their life. They don't necessarily, like the principal doesn't say that you're going to be safer, but that you're going to feel safer. What that means is they don't tangibly affect the people on the ground, the victims of police brutality, or the victims of gang violence. That's incredibly important. Let's now talk about how society will react attached to losing by cop. Here they tell us, and they try to make this analysis, that there's going to be far less police brutality and more accountability to police because suddenly you trust the police more. They never give us this mechanistic analysis, good luck in a cop reply, but importantly there, the analysis is that when there are less police, you trust them more. Like when there's a low police presence. Like they don't tell us about a militarization of police, they don't tell us about the threat that people feel when they see police, they only tell us about the physical danger that exists. What that means, now take here in a moment, is that when you're talking about like the physical danger that happens, you're talking about reducing police brutality, which involves effective policies like body cameras and accountability. If you're not able to prevent that, less police simply means that you're less safe from other crimes happening, but more of those police are less able to keep you, or that there is going to be at least a similar number of police brutality cases, people aren't going to be feeling any more safe. Yes?
If people, if the majority of these people in this area actually feel safer if police are there, only just vote for no reduction.
We think realistically that they will feel safer once police are there, but when they make the decision in the board, like in the spotlight of headlines like Mike Brown has been gunned down, when you're talking about things like that, people realistically aren't making the most rational decision. Yeah, we need to understand that the mechanistic analysis leading to more trust of police, more reporting of crimes like rape and more cooperation realistically don't exist. Specifically, when Connie gives you an analysis about how the majority of police brutality happens when police are responding to a threat, when they come into your house and you say there is rubber and they shoot you instead because you're the black person in their house. What that means is they don't reduce that risk, they don't mitigate it, they don't engage with it at all. More of what they do is that they make these police feel less safe. Yeah, Connie tells you, and there's been no response to his point about how there's going to be more brutality even with police. Less police officers. And this is that police officers might have racist tendencies, but they're able to subdue that with correct training and procedure. When you make them feel more under threat, when they know that when they touch a walkie-talkie on their shoulder, there's going to be a few extra minutes before backup arrives, they feel more at threat. That means that when you're more at threat, you respond more like an animal. Sure, these police don't want to kill people, but they want to protect themselves. What that means is that you're going to respond more on an animalistic, instinctive level. That means that you're going to be instinctively more racist. What that means is that when you see a black person coming at you with their hands in their pockets, you know that there's no back of a Roger alone. What's realistically going to happen is you're going to want to defend yourself quicker than you would otherwise. When you know that there's police around you, you're more safe. Importantly there, we can subdue racism with correct training. When you leave police officers alone, they'll feel more at home or more alone and more undefended. In that case, you're going to respond more on an instinctive level, that's often more police brutality. Here they tell us that simply five of these officers were like victims or perpetrators of police brutality, ignoring the fact that they're not dealing with any of the accountability measures that exist, where police officers are found to have killed someone, but it's said that they were just doing their job. Importantly, they don't question that at all, like how are they going to justify people without a legal reason? Yeah, they tell us that police officers are going to be afraid of doing their job, afraid of perpetrating police brutality because they'll lose their job. Importantly, this perverse incentive does exist for police, and they don't simply want to protect people out of the goodness of their heart. Realistically, they're going to get more jobs if they like allow crime to happen. Like if that is the incentive of police, where they want more jobs, they're going to allow crime to happen so people want more police. Realistically, what the outcome is going to be, regardless of how many less police you have, is that there's going to be more crime. The other response has been incredibly flippant. They say that, like, they try and mock my speaker in a different tone of voice and pretend like that's a response. Importantly, crime is an opportunistic activity. When you engage in crime, you're thinking that there's less of a chance that you're going to be caught and going to be prosecuted for that crime. That means that when there are less police around, you're less likely to be caught and less likely to be prosecuted. You're more likely to engage or join a gang because you think you're never going to see your family again. When there are more police, there is more chance of you being prosecuted, but importantly, there is more chance of there being less crime. Less crime means more people on the ground are safe. It's not about feelings up in the air, it's about the way that people live their lives. Safety is incredibly important, and we have a side that guarantees that. I'm proud to propose. Your vote.
Something that is very unlikely for a young black woman to exist in the group. In a community that is ripe for gangsterism, in a community that is impoverished, in a community where crime is something that she's always worried about in her mind. Let us then discover how Obiden is able to protect this actor. But secondly, how Obiden is able to instill trust in the police and these communities, and ultimately reduce police brutality. Firstly, on this issue on how we best cater to minorities and the community as a whole. So the first thing we get from side proposition is that, hey, there's a lot of racism, black people are being shot dead, we don't like this, police need to be moved away because this is actually not nice, right? We gave you responses saying that if the inherent issue is in fact racism, why aren't you then tackling racism? We gave the alternatives where we talked about sensitive training. We gave the alternatives where we talked about de-escalation. We gave the alternatives where we talked about body cameras. What response do we get to these alternatives? Only time is that, hey, these actually have proven to work in very minimal cases. We just kind of show that they actually are going to work, right? But in their very own case, they tell us that people are able to hold police accountable for the things that they actually do. In the same way, then, they are able to hold police accountable when there isn't sensitive training, when there isn't de-escalation, when there isn't, alternatives put in place to address issues that actually matter to these individuals. Second response we gave to this racism point, to this racism point and police presence, is that why don't you then let it happen organically when you have the government evaluate the situation and be like, hey, we actually need 50 police here because it's very dangerous. And when that, when the need then decreases, remove them. No response whatsoever. Because we told you as side opposition that government is better able to protect minorities because the definitions of crime are actually very different. We also told you here that we are therefore best able to reduce crime in its entirety when we have people who are present, when we have a deserved number of police present within the time described. But then, yeah, we also gave you a side proposition that, hey, we actually don't worsen stigma under our analysis. No response to why we actually, to this point. That is very intrinsic, especially when you want to protect minority groups. And then lastly here, they tell us, secondly here, the next issue about which side then builds trust and lessens the amount of police brutality that then exists within these kind of situations. The first thing we told you is that we allow for conversation under our case. We don't just push people away. We put people in a position where they're able to address issues, right? But they tell us that, hey, they're also able to do that. They're allowed to have a better conversation, especially when we speak about voting, right? What we told you is that voting is the final kind of a mechanism that doesn't allow for that kind of interaction. No response to this. We're not talking about conversating on the voting line. We're speaking about community members being able to speak to police and tell them that, hey, what you're doing is actually not right. What you're doing is actually something that does not benefit me, being in a better position, being in a position where I can be able to trust you and not being a person who's at risk to being attacked by all the gangs that they exist within our societies. We value this kind of communal engagement. They didn't tackle us on this issue. But then let's get down to this point of police brutality. They tell us that, hey, we lessen it because we move people away, we have transfers, people like just change. But they still haven't told us that why does the reduction equal to trust? You didn't get that kind of analysis. But what we told you is that when you don't just move people away, you force them to engage, you force them to actually be accountable in that kind of instance. And why is it this something that we cannot actually value within our main tools? We gave you alternatives, we gave you conversation, we value to your feet.
Levels of cooperation on their side, and that's the point at which they lose this debate. We are very, very proud of them.